We are very pleased to have a distinguished panel of people who have been involved in different dimensions of the Wisconsin Lakes Partnership over time, stretching back to the 1960s, if I get this right. And we're inviting them here in one way to reflect on Professor Lowell Klesig, who some people in this room knew and got to work with, but someone who really helped make these conventions what they are today. He put in a lot of his own personal time to make these events happen, starting in the 1970s when he would travel around the state to hold little meetings with anyone who wanted to talk about lake districts. And then starting in 1979 here in Stevens Point, Lowell worked with people to say, let's have just an annual statewide gathering of people involved. Primarily back then it was lake districts. And then over time we've swallowed up and encompassed all the folks involved in lake associations until today, where we're really involved in both river and watershed organizations and trying to encompass everybody who's involved in water resource management in the state. So in light of Lowell's untimely passing last summer, we wanted to get some people together who could add a little bit of sort of detail to some images of how this partnership began and talk a bit about how the partnership has evolved over time and the challenges that this partnership has faced, the challenges both at the group level down at individual lakes, but also at the statewide level dealing with governor policy and legislature. So I'm gonna introduce the first speaker and he's gonna pass the baton to the rest of the panel. Professor Steve Bourne is someone who I got to meet fortunately as a graduate student at the Urban and Regional Planning Program in Madison back in the 1990s. He's a person who's held many titles. You'll see a description of him in the plenary section of your schedule, your agenda for today. But he's most notable for, I believe he's the only person who held the title of State Planning Director. And he also had interesting times working with state energy policy. He's covered all sorts of things. And most recently, he's been engaged protecting the streams, not only of Wisconsin, but of the entire United States as part of Trout Unlimited. So the dedication to water resources is just central to Steve Bourne's character, and we're just pleased to have him here. He also served part of the reason why we bring him up too is he was the research advisor for Lowell Klesig back when he was working on his dissertation and looking at lake organizations. So he certainly knows the history. I won't take any more of his time, so please help me in welcoming Steve Bourne.
Well, it's great to be here this morning. I want to thank Eric. As a former graduate student in our program, I was speaking at an Earth Day event in Madison on Monday, and an old student came up out of the crowd, and she smiled at me and said, "You probably don't remember me, and I really didn't realize you were still alive." Thanks, Eric, for cutting me some slack. The other observation, I've been kind of doing the demographics of this crowd. If you look up at the panel, here are my colleagues, as well as a little bit of my case, you'll notice there's a small amount of gray hair. And so you can think of presentations, and I think of people this way. I like to categorize things. There are really only two kinds of people in the world: pre-PowerPoint and post-PowerPoint. And we are in the pre-PowerPoint category based on the color of hair and so forth and so on. Well, it's a pleasure to be here at the Lakes Convention, and what I'm going to try to do is provide a little bit of history and lay the foundation for the Wisconsin Lakes Partnership of today. Now, you all know that Wisconsin had been a longtime leader in lake research. In fact, the whole science of limnology was developed by Burge and Jude down at Madison many, many years ago. So it's quite fitting that lakes programs that are pioneering in nature happen in Wisconsin, given that we were the birthplace, really, of the science of limnology. Years later, in the 60s, the Water Resources Center in the state got designated as a national center of excellence for eutrophication research, to try to study what was involved in the over-fertilization of our lakes. And of course, Wisconsin has long been a champion of the Wisconsin idea, where people working within university environments and university extension has a major responsibility to provide service to governments and people of the state of Wisconsin. And the lake program built up on that platform as well. And finally, our Department of Natural Resources had a wonderful reputation as a professional conservation organization with strong scientific capabilities, and all of those are part of the elements that built the foundation for the state of Wisconsin becoming the site of a project funded by the Upper Great Lakes Regional Commission in 1968. It was a project called the Inland Lake Demonstration Project. It existed from 1968 to 1974. And interestingly, funded by the Upper Great Lakes Regional Commission, which was within the Department of Commerce. So it really was an economic agency funding a project to look at lakes in the upper Midwest and Wisconsin, Minnesota, and Michigan, and a recognition that these lake resources were a valuable economic asset, as well as absolutely a critical component spiritually and many other ways for people living and recreating on these wonderful resources. I think the Upper Great Lakes Regional Commission was also prompted to fund this effort because these resources were under threat. Growing recreational pressures, more development, some of the impacts of agriculture and other discharges on our lakes. And so how could we find a balance to manage, restore these lakes where appropriate, to engage people in their protection, and capitalize on both the economic values and the environmental values of these very special resources? This was a joint venture of the University of Wisconsin Extension and the DNR. And back in those days, when $1 million was actually $1 million, that's about the funding level. It was about a little bit over $1 million over a period of 5+ years. The goals of this project, and incidentally, on the way up, I rode up with Bill O'Connor, and we were reminiscing about those who were still alive and those who weren't. But along the way, I read the annual or the final report of the Inland Lake Demonstration Project, which was in March 74, and I remember writing this thing, and when I went back and looked at it, I thought, gee, the person who wrote this was just absolutely brilliant. I didn't know any of this stuff. But I'm told that Eric has a copy of that, and for any of you that want to look at some of the roots of history, I think you might find it there. But the goals of the project were to try to demonstrate in an action-oriented program techniques to restore, maintain, and protect high-quality environments both within lakes and adjacent to lakes on their shoreline, and to try to apply that across the region. In fact, we worked nationally on this. An especially significant feature of this project was the blending together of the experience and the capabilities and the expertise of both educational agencies and regulatory agencies in Wisconsin to address these lake-related problems. Now, many of you are familiar from projects within your own lakes of the toolkit, the array of things you can do to try to restore or rehabilitate or to manage your lake. And a lot of that work got done through this project, trying to assess all the different techniques to renew or rehabilitate lakes by limiting nutrient inputs, limiting sediments, and in cases where you couldn't curb the input of things which are causing a problem in your lake, to come up with ways to better manage your lake, sometimes in a cosmetic way, but to make it more usable to folks. And we had a whole set of projects statewide looking at these different techniques, from nutrient inactivation with alum to aeration projects to littoral zone management projects, all kinds of different things. Now, while this project recognized, like I'm sure most of you have become aware of, that lakes are very complex ecosystems, it also recognized that the energies and the cooperation of both the public and the private sector were going to be necessary to really tackle this management job. And one of the key features of that was recognizing that lakeshore property owners and citizens in lake communities were generally an overlooked resource to help solve these problems. So a concern was, how do we engage these people who have the most immediate interest in the lake resources in their protection and management? It's at this point that a young, at that point in time, PhD student named Lowell Klesig came to us. He was a rural sociology PhD student, and he worked with Professor Doug Yangin in the law school, who was one of my close colleagues in this effort. But their very important studies were not on the lakes, but were on you folks. Were on the roles of lake property owners and the activities that they pursued, and how did they organize to try to undertake work around their lake. Additionally, the lake project, lake program that we were leading in the state, put together a huge array of educational materials and also staffing capabilities to engage the citizenry around the state as a very important component of moving forward in the future. Now, we had a lot of positive results and some failures in these various field projects, but we really got a handle on what the toolkit looked like, and in fact, convened at the end of the project an international conference, which brought together people working with the management of lakes from all around the world and created a document which was sort of the Bible for EPA when they initiated their Clean Lakes program. So that was one of the very positive outputs. The second thing that happened that was influential in the project's life and going forward was the evaluation of the human dimensions of lake management. It was this focus on property owners and property owner attitudes and an assessment of lake property and lake management organizations in other states, an intense look at legislative programs that had been enacted across the nation, what worked, what didn't work, and then this very intense public and technical education program. And all of this led, really, I like to think of it as kind of like a souffle. You put it in the oven flat, you cooked it for 5 years and hoped it would rise and be something beautiful. And in fact, that happened in this particular case. There was a lot of vigorous cooperative work with legislators and their staff, and that ranged all the way through from the drafting to the public hearings to the ultimate enactment of Chapter 33 and lake program legislation. And out of the archives, hidden in a box someplace on my sun porch, I found the early document, a state local lake rehabilitation program, a proposed bill and commentary. And this laid the groundwork then for the legislative negotiation and bringing all the parts together. And I just want to stop and give you an example of a couple of people, because it's people that drive this thing that were pivotal. We did a project up in Marion, Wisconsin. Does anybody know where Marion is? Okay. And there's a mayor up there named Bill Bertram. All these guys are long dead, men and women. And the principal antagonist up there was a guy named Ozzie Lutzewitz, who worked at one of the little industrial complexes. These guys became bulldogs on this subject. They were lake leaders before we identified lake leaders. And they pestered and worked with their legislator, a Republican named Brownie Byers from up in that neck of the world. And Brownie, along with a number of bipartisan legislators, led the effort to institutionalize this program. Another kind of lake leader person, before there were lake leader programs, was a banker up in New Richmond named John Soderberg, who early on, I think, was one of the first officers of the Wisconsin Association of Lakes. And John was able to pull together the financial, the development community, the stress from a citizen's perspective, the importance of these lake resources, and was just a pivotal guy in testifying in front of legislative committees and getting this program enacted. Voila, the new program emerges, the new lakes program in 1974. Pat Lucey was the governor at that time. And that program had embedded in it many of the things that you folks benefit from and work with today. It had provisions for educational staffing. We called them lake specialists. And back in the day, there were guys like George Gibson, who some of you may remember, Ron Hennings, and other people who were the lake specialists working with lake property owners and hopefully then the new districts and just generally education with people interested in Wisconsin lakes. There was a provision for new institutional arrangements. It created the lake districts. And a number of you, I was talking earlier, with some of you had served for 20 and 30 years on your lake district boards, and you're trying to figure out succession arrangements besides dying and creating some space for some younger people to come forward and take up this leadership. But the arrangements to have these lake districts was the result of a lot of study on our part, including an assessment of sanitary districts and how they worked and how they might be used. And our original idea was, of course, you'd want to include the whole watershed of the lake in a lake district. But you can imagine that there was some resistance, as there is today, from landowners who live upstream, perhaps are farmers or whatever, who don't see the immediate benefits that the lakeside property owners do, so we came up with a more constricted arrangement. But that's where the lake districts came from. There was also a grant program put in place to support planning and implementation of local lake projects, and finally, really strengthening the DNR staffing capability to focus on lakes. So what are a couple of the lessons that we take away from this experience? Well, it's been a lot of changes and a lot of different stresses, and some of them are going on now, in the years since this early enactment of Chapter 33. But the success of the Basic Lakes Partnership is still validated. Putting together Wisconsin Lakes, the Association of Lakes, citizens generally, the public as one corner of a tripod stool, along with DNR, the Resource Management Agency, and along with the educational resources of Extension, has been an important part of sustaining this. And it also, I think, clearly acknowledges that no one party is responsible for protecting or maintaining our lakes. It's a shared responsibility. Another lesson, I think, is the importance of good science in managing lakes. It's great to hope that every lake looks like Lake Tahoe or like Tomahawk or whatever it happens to be, clear, but some of our lakes are not going to be oligotrophic and are going to have weeds and are going to have other things. Let's use our science to tell us what we can realistically do, what we know and don't know. And Wisconsin has been notable, I think, over the years in lake management and shoreline management programs for relying on good science. And finally, nothing is more critical, not only in enacting legislation, and I spent my time for 5 years not only on these lake projects and developing materials and so forth, but working with lake leaders and working with people in various communities around the state so that when it finally came time to try to pass legislation and establish this program, we could put 1,000 letters on the desk of Jim Holperin down in the Capitol saying, we support this program, this is what Wisconsin wants. So building that public awareness, that understanding, that involvement in the policy process at every level is critical, not just to starting up these programs, but to maintaining them over time. And it's hard to keep that energy flowing. In that regard, one of Lowell's ideas, the creation of the Lake Leader Institute, and how many of you are lake leaders? Have you gone through the lake? Yeah. Good stuff. I mean, that is building the civic capacity of Wisconsin. That's the way we share stewardship for our lakes. So that Lake Leaders program was a great program and continues to be a great program to get leadership at the grassroots level. The final thing I want to mention before I turn to my compadres here is in about 19, Bill and I were arguing in the car. He's getting a little senile and my memory is, my bandwidth is narrowed considerably, but my memory is great on small things. And we were trying to remember at one point in time, and I think it was 1978 or thereabouts, the Legislative Audit Bureau did an audit. This was right after this Lakes program and the new legislation and all the things that you folks are involved with had won a prize as the leading environmental program to be initiated that year. People went over to Japan to accept awards and so forth, and it was just a real benchmark program. 4 years later, the Legislative Audit Bureau was recommending the program be terminated. And the analyst doing that was one of my former students. And I had a talk with him that, you know, degrees are given out, but they're not permanent. They can be rescinded. But that didn't happen. There were some serious problems with the program. The grant program had too many cosmetic dredging projects that were high cost and were palliative and didn't deal with problems. There were organizational issues that arose. And as you will see going forward from here, that raised a set of questions about the Lakes program that was to create some anxiety in the coming years. With no further ado, I turned to Bill O'Connor. Bill was also a student in the Water Resources Management Program at Madison, and I had been chair of that program at different points in time. But what I remembered about Bill, and you'll soon recognize if you haven't met Bill before, is this absolutely melodious voice, this deep, resonant voice. And he used to do these things for Earthwatch, and you'd hear there'd be little stories about this or that related to the Earth. And I thought, God, what a wonderful voice this fellow has. I wonder what his personality's like. I'll let you determine that. Bill O'Connor.
Steve, thank you very much. I feel very, very honored to have an opportunity to return this year and attend the Wisconsin Lakes Convention and have a few moments with all of you. I studied at the feet of giants like Steve and others at the University of Wisconsin and the state of Wisconsin who put together the origins of the Wisconsin's Lakes Partnership and the laws that we have now developed over a period of almost 40 years to manage Wisconsin lakes. I was a graduate student in water resources and then decided I should go off to law school because in that era of the 1970s environmental movement, it didn't seem like enough to me to be writing about this stuff as I was doing at the time. I wanted to do something about it. And this got me into a track that had me working for a judge as a law clerk after I finished law school. And in the summer of 81, when I finished up that clerkship, I wrote a letter to a law firm that I had promised to come and work for in Chicago, and I said, well, I've changed my mind. I'm not going to do this. I guess I've got Wisconsin in my bones. And I didn't show up at a law firm on the 75th floor of the Sears Tower that August. Instead, I made a youthful, probably there were people in my family who thought a foolhardy decision to strike out on my own, establish a solo private law practice out of a spare bedroom in my apartment, and try and practice law in the areas of land and water conservation. And I did that. And I didn't know much about how I would get my first client in that, but I thought that the place to go at first might be the University of Wisconsin Extension. And I knew that there had been a lake program created, and I knew that there was someone in Madison, Steve mentioned his name, George Gibson, who was a lake specialist at 1815 University Avenue. So I went over to meet with George to find out, you know, what's up with this lake stuff. I didn't have any clients, so I had plenty of time. Well, George told me something that really was one of the most important things that I learned in my career. He told me that there had been this audit completed a couple of years before, and the Lakes program that had begun with a glow of sunshine and great early successes. Lowell Klesig had gone around the state and organized the first, I guess, several dozen lake districts, and the program was recognized in some quarters as a great national model. But now all of a sudden it was on the skids because the State Legislative Audit Bureau report had kind of cut the program to the quick. And that as a result of that, I learned Lowell Klesig and some others had gathered. And these were people who were involved in the first round of Lake District formation. And they had decided a matter of a couple of months before I was in his office that morning in 1981, they decided that they should form a group called the Wisconsin Association of Lake Districts so that they would be in a position to counter the adverse direction the program was going because of this audit. And that there was a fellow who was a vice chancellor at the University of Wisconsin in Milwaukee named Bill Walters who had been tasked with their trying to hire a lobbyist. And I thought, that's interesting. So I called this Bill Walters at UWM and, well, starting about 6 weeks after that and for the next 30 years, I did legislative and lobbying and law work for the Wisconsin Association of Lake Districts, and later, after it merged with the Wisconsin Federation of Lakes, the Wisconsin Association of Lakes. And it was a tremendous privilege for me to work in this important area in the state. I grew up on lakes as a child in Portage, Wisconsin, and my grandfather had lived in Ashland, and so I spent time on Lake Superior. So I think I do have Wisconsin land and water in my veins, and it was a terrific honor for me to have the opportunity to work on lakes for some 30 years. When I came in, the program was on the skids. Very early in my tenure as Wall's lobbyist, Governor Tony Earle was elected in 82, And he came in with a biennial budget proposal in January or February of 1983 that included the repeal of Chapter 33. At that time, there was a grant program buried in Chapter 33, and if you go look, you'll see that it's still there. It's called the Inland Lake Renewal Grant Program. And my great opening legislative success for the Wisconsin Association of Lake Districts was to convince legislators that rather than repealing the program, that they should just eliminate the funding. The state had a $1 billion deficit going into the 1983 budget cycle, and I succeeded in getting them not to completely repeal Chapter 33, although I failed at retaining any of the funds for the program. Mixed blessing. But from that base, over a period of about 30 years, the Lakes partnership was successful in bringing the program back and then for some years building further and further on the foundation that was really laid by Steve and his colleagues under Governor Lucy in the 1970s. One of the earliest things that my hiring man, Bill Walters, said was, we need to get a stable base of funding. And in the early 1980s, I found a guy who could help do that for the Wisconsin Association of Lakes, and that was State Assembly Representative Jim Holperin, who's seated to my right. And Jim and I worked, I had established a relationship with a fellow who I got to know on the when I was on the board of my local lake association, the Mendota-Monona Lake Property Owners Association, it was called at the time, a guy named Jim Clouser, who had become, when Tommy Thompson was elected governor, Secretary of Administration, and as Thompson described him, the second governor. Jim Clouser was a very consequential state official for many years during the dozen years that Tommy was governor. And Jim Clouser was a lake guy. And between Jim's interest in the administration and Jim Holperin's interest, we were successful in getting legislation through that recognized that motorboats use gasoline and that the excise tax on gasoline used in motorboats shouldn't be used for road maintenance. They should be used for water-related projects. And so one of the foundation steps in building the partnership was to get the legislature to recognize that and incorporate that into state law. Jim is the one who deserves most of the credit for that. And what it has established is a program that calculates the revenue from motorboats and assigns it to a separate fund called the Water Resources Account. And by my reckoning, Jim, and I didn't study this in detail in the last couple of days, but I think it's pretty close to $200 million has been allocated from that to maintain lake grant programs and other programs associated with lake management over the last roughly 20 years. A second step that was an important legislative step that Wall had a very active role in was the establishment of the Lake Classification Program. And I just want to take 1 minute to tell a war story. Back in the early 60s, Governor Nelson had an interest in lake management, Gaylord Nelson. And one of the laws that they passed before there was a DNR in the early 1960s was a law that authorized the then Conservation Commission to classify lakes. And the Conservation Commission never did it, and DNR didn't either. And I think it was because there are too many ways you could classify lakes: size, degree of development, degree of boating activity, water quality, fisheries, and it never got anywhere. And I was interested in the idea because in the time that I'd spent working on Wisconsin Lakes Matters, I realized that, you know, there's quite a lot of difference between the 600 or 700 mud lakes we have in the state, many of which are smaller than 50 acres, and Lake Superior, for example. They're pretty different. But most of the state policies and statutes that govern lakes just talk about lakes. They don't make any distinction. So I was interested in this idea of lakes classification. And one year in the late 90s, I succeeded in getting former Senator Gaylord Nelson to speak at one of these conferences. And I had the pleasure of picking him up in Madison and driving him up for the day. And along the way, I probed him on this. I said, "What, Senator, you guys passed this lake classification authority back in 61 or 2. What were you guys trying to do with that?" And Gaylord said, well, I'll tell you, Bill, you know, what we thought at the time was that if a fella could row a boat across a lake in, say, you know, 20 minutes, they shouldn't have any motorboats on a lake like that. That's what lake classification meant in 1961. But in the 1997 budget, with the devoted work of still-seated Senator Rob Coles from Green Bay, the legislature passed a law that created a lakes classification program that had important elements. One of them was that it authorized counties to designate categories of lakes, classes of lakes, and to implement management policies at the county and local level that was based on the characteristics of lakes. But it also provided the first of what are sometimes called capacity grants. There was a recognized need, if you were going to do lake classification activity, to have a source of expertise. Senator Coles wasn't willing to create new positions in the state government to have new hires who would show up as new state employees during that administration. That wasn't an acceptable thing politically. But he recognized the need to do it. And I remember the meeting in which somebody, and I won't say who, responding to Senator Coles' concern about adding new state positions, said, let Billy's group do it. Which meant, why don't we instead fund this lake classification technical need by providing a grant, not creating state jobs, but giving a grant to a nonprofit organization, then it could engage the personnel necessary to carry on lakes classification. And that grant was awarded to the Wisconsin Association of Lakes and has been consistently for 18 years now. And that is one of the items that, as many of you probably know, is scheduled for repeal in the budget bill that is currently pending before the legislature. So we may be, again, at a juncture comparable to the situation when I first became involved in lakes advocacy in 1981. We don't have an audit report that looks bad, but we do have a major proposed change in state policy that would kind of pull an important feature out of the lakes partnership. Before I sign off, and I will promise to do it quickly, I just want to credit Lowell Klesig with an important role that he had in building this kind of tribal community of lake people, and remind people that whatever happens in the state budget this time or the next time around, it's the core of really devoted individuals, whether they're academic and policy people, legislators like Jim Holperin and Cal Potter, who we get the pleasure of hearing later today, or lake property owners and people active in local lake communities. That's where WAL and the Lakes Partnership has been the most effective over the years and will be in the future. Thank you.
Well, thanks, Bill, and thank you, Eric, also for inviting me to be a part of the panel today. Many of you might not know that the panel members were invited initially back in November, way before the state budget was introduced. And given the potential impact of that budget on this organization and on lake programs around Wisconsin, I'm sure Eric might be sitting here thinking, man, oh, man, oh, man, you know, I should have invited three dudes from the governor's office or from the legislature to come in and explain just what the hell's happening to us here. So I'm not so sure, even though while I have a tremendous amount of respect for Steve Bourne and for Bill O'Connor, I've worked with them for many, many years on lakes programs. I'm not so sure that the reflections of a triumvirate of dinosaurs is exactly what this organization needs right now. But it was great to hear both their summaries, because the history of lake programs in Wisconsin is of tremendous importance. This organization obviously has great value to this state and will continue to into the future no matter what happens legislatively. But I guess looking ahead, you know, sadly, history, which we've heard a lot of today, increasingly is not very helpful in guiding, especially political and legislative policy for organizations around this state. You know, I was in the legislature for 16 years, involved in state government for 25 all told, And I am today completely unqualified to offer any good political or any other advice to this organization or make any reliable predictions about what the legislature might or might not do. That is how dramatically politics in Wisconsin has changed over the past couple of years. You know, stock investors are familiar with the phrase that past performance is no guarantee of future results. And that, I think that's never been more true than in Wisconsin politics today. Well, like anyone, like all of you, you know, I've got a boatload of suppositions and opinions and ideas about what's going on in the legislature today in the governor's office, and you're going to hear some of that during the question and answer period. But please, for your own good, do not pay any attention to what I say. Instead, I think you should, as an organization, keep whistling that Fleetwood Mac song, "Don't Stop Thinking About Tomorrow." You know, yesterday's gone, you know. And remember the fade out at the end of the song? Ooh, don't you look back. Hockey great Wayne Gretzky was a little more succinct with his advice to skate where the puck will be, not where it is. So I think this organization and a dozen others like it around the state that are in the same kind of situation, they're all valued and respected partners in making this state a clean and attractive and productive state. We'll need to figure out where the puck will be, and soon. One hint, it might not be at the state capitol. So you're faced with a daunting challenge here today at your annual meeting and going forward. But Wisconsin Lakes, as Bill O'Connor suggested, has faced adversity before. And I know all of you are ready for that challenge and for that change. To conclude, we were to talk a little bit about Lowell Klesig and his tremendous impact on starting this program and sustaining it to where it is today. And I wanted to repeat a little bit of wisdom that Mary Plattner, whom all of you know from years and years of attendance and leadership in this organization from up in Vilas County, Alma and Moon Lake, whispered to me earlier today that many of you might not know Lowell Klesig offered the first office for the Wisconsin Association of Lakes. Way back when he was at the University of Wisconsin, Stevens Point, he offered them a room in an old women's dorm here on campus. And for 4 years, the first office of the Wisconsin Association of Lakes was here on the campus and in that dorm. And so, like in many ways, in policy terms and legislative terms, getting this organization off the ground and on its feet, Lowell provided that space originally for the organization. So looking forward to the question and answers today, and thank you all for attending this year's conference. I hope that you take a lot away from it.
Now, it's a bit of a Wisconsin Lakes Partnership Convention tradition to have time from the floor for people to ask questions of the presenters that are before them at the plenary session. We certainly want to open this time up for you. My colleague and fellow Extension Lakes specialist, Patrick Goggin, is in the back. He's holding a microphone. He's willing to basically go run to anybody who has a question if they want to raise their hand. We got someone way over here on the other side, it looks like. So, we have another microphone. I can't see with the light. So my other colleague, Aaron McFarland, is over here also with a microphone. So please do not be shy. These gentlemen are not harmful, I can promise. We actually had some discussion too, and you guys are welcome to sort of ask each other questions too as we're going. We want this to be a bit of an engaged panel and allow you guys to participate in the free spirit of exchange of ideas. One question I have sort of just, and maybe this reflects some people's sentiment, when times were tough, when things do get thrown on the rocks, and I think, Steve, you've seen this too, not just in the Lakes program, but in other programs, and certainly Jim, other programs in the state have been subject to budget cuts and being shrunk down. What do you tell yourself, I think, looking forward? How do you think about the future in a positive way in light of those things? I know it's one thing to think of the song and to be trying to chant to yourself, maybe, but are there some techniques or places you look for inspiration to say, well, you know, maybe something good will come out of this?
I'll take a first shot at it. I don't have a song like Jim, and if I did, I wouldn't sing it as well. I really enjoyed that. And it shows something about my taste in music. This is just one person's opinion. I'll use the same caveats that my colleagues did up here. But the support for basic science, a reliance on science, has really deteriorated. This is a state, remember, where birthplace of limnology, Aldo Leopold providing a scientific basis for game management, all the things that have happened here, the DDT prohibitions based on science here in Wisconsin, and there, we've seen a lot of erosion. We've seen cutbacks in staffing proposed, cutbacks in research funding. There's been cutbacks in environmental monitoring. There's a lesser role of the university in terms of some people not understanding the Wisconsin idea and the contribution to Wisconsin it can make. And then just the overall, Jim says there's been a sea change here, the politicization of science. And I used to use Florida as an example. I, you know, boy, you want to see some stupid stuff, go to Florida. The Department of Environmental Protection there won't let any of their staffers use the word climate change. Now I don't even have to go to Florida. I can do it right here in Wisconsin. I like that. I call that homegrown stupidity. and would happily say it. But Eric says, where are the bright spots here? To some degree, these losses have been offset by the gains in the work of folks like you, civic engagement, citizen science, lake monitoring programs. Early on in the 60s when we were saying lake people can do a lot of this monitoring themselves, a Secchi disc, whatever it happens to be, basic kinds of monitoring things, this sort of arrogance of expertise that, oh no, you won't be able to trust that science. You don't have to be Houdini to look into one of today's bass boats to see more damn science than there was in half of our laboratories in the 1960s. Don't worry about these men and women being able to get basic parameters on water and add valuable information. So that's really helped. There's been a whole array of these programs, not just by citizen groups, but by schools and nonprofits and so forth. My view is that these activities should be a complement and not a substitute for good science by government, good engagement by government. But the idea is don't look to the capital to solve everything. The strength is in having a lot of nuclei, a lot of activity out there in the landscape of Wisconsin. It will help us, I think, work through the very tough seas that we're sometimes coming into now in terms of support. But I think one of the hallmarks of Wisconsin is the civic capacity, the let's all pitch in together, whether it's lakes, rivers, land trusts, trout streams, or outside the resource area. That's been a hallmark of this state. And cutting out the funding, that, and it's minuscule funding, really, that helps support these kinds of activities is not a move forward in the terms of the direction I see for Wisconsin to provide our citizens, lake leaders, lake communities, to do the stuff they have to do. But I think, my guess is you're going to be resilient during these tough times. And stuff will go on. There'll be damage here, damage there. But the baseline, the core, can be maintained as long as you're committed to it.
I have a question over here.
Sure.
Hi, Eric and Jim. That's AJ Tyler. And I've been hiding out in the Rio Grande Valley, so I'm going to ask some questions. This is the first I heard of these draconian cuts. Are these cuts so bad that we're cutting into the legislative required gas tax diversion?
Yeah, so the question is the water resource account really being hit by this? And Bill, you might have some insight, but my understanding is it's not, that the water resources account and the gasoline tax for motorboats is pretty much still sound. And do you, Bill, can you comment too on like when you guys were establishing that, what sort of safeguards do you put in place? How do you put something in there that can't easily be robbed or transferred into other things.
Well, the water resources account is a component of something called the Conservation Fund. And there's a chapter of the statutes that establishes so-called trust funds. One of them is well known, the highway, the Transportation Trust Fund. Another one is the Conservation Fund. The water resources account is part of the Conservation Fund. Another part has the money that comes from fishing and hunting license fees, for example. And they're just statutes. And so the legislature has the authority to change those statutes and from time to time use money that may have been raised for one purpose and spend it on something else. Some of you may recall that, was it 2 years ago, there was an amendment to the Wisconsin State Constitution adopted that made the Transportation Trust Fund untouchable for any purpose other than transportation. There is no such constitutional protection for the Conservation Fund, let alone the Water Resources Account. I'm not as close a student as this as I was when I had a professional relationship with the Wisconsin Association of Lakes, but my understanding is that this budget doesn't change the formula for determining how much of the gas tax is transferred to the Conservation Fund for water-related programs. It's just changing how the money is being spent. I understand that the money, the portion of it that's used for the lake grant program is substantially at the same level that it's been in past years, but the amounts that were used to support the so-called Lake Classification Technical Assistance Grant to the Wisconsin Association of Lakes is terminated, and some related, sometimes called capacity grants, were terminated.
One of the things also, I think, when I think about that water resources account and the sort of logic of the gasoline tax, when I talk to students or talk to lake groups, I point out, I think it happened afterward, that the ATV people and the snowmobile people came along with that. And they said, hey, wait a minute, if you're taking the motorboat money and putting it in lakes, how about my snowmobile money goes to snowmobile trails? And how about my ATV money goes to ATV programs? And then when I think of the political power that that triumvirate would have, ATVers, snowmobilers, lake enthusiasts, I can't think of a lawmaker who would turn their back on that group or somehow put them out in the cold without, you know, greatly contemplating the consequences. Does that, did those ATV things come later in the snowmobile, and have those groups ever kind of risen up to say, look, we gotta make sure, especially in light of the Transportation Fund amendment to the Constitution, why don't all three of those groups get together? And actually, a follow-up question for Steve will be, how do we get lake groups and anglers to collaborate more? Because it seems as though that's always a tricky one to do too. So we'll go to Jim and then to Steve.
Well, I think it is very fortunate that the legislature didn't touch either Chapter 33 or the segregated motorboat, so-called motorboat gas tax. And there's a reason for that. I mean, there's a reason that the cuts were made to your organization, and that there are a reason that the integrity of the water resources account generally was not disturbed. And I think that's a good thing. So you're kind of back to where you were in 1981. Yeah, you might lose 200 grand in capacity grants and support for Wisconsin lakes, but the base of the statute remains intact. And that's a very fortunate thing, and I think shows strength politically behind the programs that the Water Resources Account does sponsor. And I just jotted down, I know you're talking about your capacity grants and thinking, why would the legislature do that? I jotted down four conceivable reasons why the legislature might cut your capacity grants. Number one.
Could you go slow?
And I guess this is, it's a governor's budget, so this is from the legislature may indeed restore this money. I don't know that the odds are very high for that, but the first reason, we understand and we value what Wisconsin Lakes does with that money, but budgets are about priorities, and it pains us deeply, but there are simply higher priorities, or maybe returning the money to the taxpayer. So you're just not a high priority in the budget. Number two, we really don't understand what you do with the money, and if we did understand, we probably don't really value what you do with the money. So this is simply a not a good investment of our tax dollars. It's basically wasteful spending, so you're done. Number three, kind of the conspiracy theory, we all understand what you do, we kind of value what you do, but this is a budget process, we need a lot of shells on the table so that you lose track of where the P is. The legislature may restore part or all of your funding, and at that point you'll be so grateful and relieved that you won't be so upset about cutting millions out of stewardship or cutting science positions at the DNR. So that's kind of the conspiracy theory. And fourth, we understand and we value what you do, but your organization, frankly, along with a dozen other environmental organizations, are just a nuisance. You oppose most of the changes we want to make in the statutes to things like shoreland zoning and water regulations that might help business. In short, by cutting funding, we can slow you down, maybe stop you, and that's what we're going to do. So, you know, choose one, I guess, or a combination, but those are kind of the reasons why budgets are cut. And like I say, it's very fortunate Chapter 33 wasn't disturbed, nor the water resources account.
You can see why Jim was such a successful legislator. Once he lays out that rationale and you're arguing your case, what could you possibly say, right? But you have to say something. And the question that Eric raises is a darn good one. How many of you are fishermen or women? How many of you are anglers? Could you raise your hand? It's like about half. So I was the national chair of Trout Unlimited, and that's 150,000 or so anglers. It's a small number of the several million trout anglers in the country. But whether you were fishing for trout and worried about trout conservation or bass or muskies or whatever your deal is, there has historically been this cleavage that Eric alluded to between the hook and bullet crowd and the environmental community. And it's hard to imagine that. There are a number of partnerships at work now. One of them is called the Theodore Roosevelt Partnership, trying to bridge the interests of the environmentalist and the hook and bullet crowd. And you wonder why there's a gap there, because absent a healthy environment, I mean, if you have a healthy environment, healthy land and waters, that will take care of the availability of fish and game and so forth. But you, job number one is to protect that base. So why isn't there a fusion between those two? It's a powerful political force, just as Eric was saying, when you put together snowmobilers and ATVers along with other people with shared interest, it becomes a powerful lobby to come up and talk to legislators and try to make the case. So I think achieving that fusion, not treating somebody who's worried about wetland protection or worried about agricultural runoff and discharges as somebody divorced from your interest in catching a big muskie on a fly, those are shared interests, and you have to try to find the areas of common interest where you can move forward. That's what interest groups are all about. It doesn't mean you agree on everything and want to get married tomorrow. It means that you find an area that you share an interest in, and you're going to try to affect the policy process in that regard. That leads to one other issue, and that's the messaging. If you're talking to Representative Holperin or many of his successors, you've got to find a way to tell that message that responds to the points that Jim raised. Why it's valuable, who's it valuable to, are there opportunities for efficiency, or are you doing good things with the monies available? So getting that message right, and particularly having the message delivered not by the head of DNR, not by the lake program leader in extension, but by the citizens of Wisconsin who are most dramatically affected by these changes, that's crucial. And I assume that your organizations will have some discussions today about the kinds of messages you want to deliver and who's going to deliver them.
We have another question from the audience.
Got a question over here.
Okay.
Thanks, gentlemen, for coming and sharing your perspectives. I think it's actually really valuable to have those the historical foundations and those experiences so we can kind of know where we've been and then be smart about where we're going. So I'm interested in where we're going and that analogy of Wayne Gretzky skating to the puck. And I'm intrigued, Senator Holperin, you said it's not potentially going to be at the Capitol anymore. Can you expand on that? And what do you mean by that? And where is the puck going to be? Where should we be looking in the future as a partnership?
Well, if you're talking about $200,000 in capacity grants, I mean, if you're strictly talking about cash to run the organization, I think there are some models out there, and I mean, they're somewhat difficult to emulate depending on how you approach it. But I mean, the state of Wisconsin is going to start naming its parks after corporate sponsors. And I think there are a number of corporations that would like to be involved with your organization but are not now. There's a lot of fiscal capacity in your membership and in lake districts all around the state. I live on a lake up in the township of Conover on Pioneer Lake, and I certainly have the means to contribute $500 to an organ. I'm already a member of the Wisconsin Association of the Wisconsin Lakes, but I've got the capacity to donate another couple hundred dollars if times are really tight and the organization really needs it. And I think there's a lot of that giving capacity out there. Now that means essentially turning yourself into Wisconsin Public Radio or Public TV, and they're being cut too, so you're going to hear more from them. But certainly the giving capacity of your members and those who support lakes and rivers and waterways around the state. And then there have to be some creative ways to attract more money, perhaps federal government grants, perhaps. I don't know, that's where strategy and planning comes in, and I'm sure you'll be sitting in several of those meetings in the next few months trying to figure out where that 200 grand is going to come from, if that's what you need. But there are ways other organizations have done it, and there are ways your organization is going to have to do it. Because whoever said it's not at the Capitol, I don't think that 200 grand's at the Capitol for the next few years.
Yeah, and Tim might have been asking where the policy puck is going, and I think still some of the policy puck is going to be at the Capitol. It's just not clear that these groups, us at the table, have any room at their table to be engaged in that policy process. It seems as though it's getting sort of more and more of a small group of elite people deciding what's going to happen and less of a populist thing. One thing that might be happening, though, it seems Wisconsin used to, and Steve, you can attest to this, we led the way for the federal government. One thing that seems that was incredibly prescient about the Inland Lake Renewal Study is that it almost anticipated an EPA grant program that would be made available to any state who happened to have done the work ahead of time to be prepared to receive these federal grants. And coincidentally then, only a handful of states were in that position to actually take full advantage of that federal money, Wisconsin being one of them. And for a long time there was a Clean Lakes program within the EPA, but we worked complementary. It seems as though the worm is turning, and we're almost at a point where the EPA has to start looking at Wisconsin's programs and wondering if we're really carrying out the Clean Water Act responsibilities, if we're really qualified just to be given blanket money the way we have from the federal government before. Do you get any sense that maybe there's this a state-federal battle on the horizon?
In our telephone conference call, trying to figure out what the questions might be and how we might answer, was Jim who said, "Well, we wouldn't want to get political." Gaylord Nelson always used to say that the economy is a wholly owned subsidiary of the environment, and I think that's axiomatic. I think it's true. If you want a little bit larger scale demonstration of it, take a look at China today. The economy was going hell-bent. Now you take a look at pictures from Shanghai and Beijing, and everybody's got masks on, the smog, the pollution issues are threatening the hierarchy of the Communist Party there. The water pollution is just absolutely horrendous. So at some point, as Jim was alluding to, it's a question of priorities. Where does the priority of a healthy natural environment for your mental state of well-being, for your recreational activities, for the sense of place you have about your lake places, for the opportunity to raise your children in that kind of environment with those shared experiences, where does that fit on the priority list versus helping out some hedge fund manager? I mean, there's some questions to be asked. There's a lot of allocations, different scales of value involved here. It's a negotiation process. But looking at where the puck's going to go, I don't think Wisconsinites will allow the puck to go too far downhill. I do think it is sliding downhill. I do think environmental protection is not a top priority, as it might have been at some earlier point in time. And you could argue it might not be the objective of environmental protection, it might be about the means, anti-regulatory focus versus some other kinds of approaches. But I think Wisconsinites, by and large, both by history and by their interest and by their look at the next generation, the generations beyond that, want a healthy, clean environment in which they can work and recreate. And that's why activity all across the state by different groups affected by prevailing legislation and so forth, and by learning to better tell your story and to get to your legislators or throw out your legislators and elect new legislators who share some of your priorities, those are all part of the agenda in leading towards an action-oriented focus. And if you see it going so far down that there is a fundamental threat to the things that you call Wisconsin in your lakes and shorelands and that general environment, then the recourse you have is really a political recourse at the local level, the state level, and the national level. And you have to think in those terms. And Jim made one important point in terms of money. It turns out that if you look at the demographics of lake property owners, it's a pretty healthy demographic. And for many of you, it's not a question of an ability to give a couple $100 more. You could easily do $1,000. It's just a different demographic than working on an urban stream in Milwaukee. And so there is an opportunity here through intergenerational giving, bequest, working with your lake district or property owners association, an endowment to Extension Lakes or to Wall, whatever it happens to be. There's a way of using your resources to further the things that you hold dear. And I think that ought to be part of the consideration.
I think we have time for one more question, if someone has a question in the audience. We got one right in the middle there.
Excuse me. I'm not sure if I should phrase it a question. I guess I want your opinion on this. So what I'm seeing lately that gives me a real sign of hope is kind of a resurgence of the Silent Spring generation, where there's, with all the stuff that's going on right now, I'm looking around and I'm looking at my own community and other communities, and grassroots stuff is popping up everywhere of people realizing problems. Just in my own community in Lake Mills, Wisconsin, in the last couple of months, we had a hugely attended presentation about the Enbridge pipeline possible expansion, and then their increase in capacity, but also some folks got wind because people are already being approached for getting their land bought by Enbridge to do an additional pipeline to the one that's already here. There's all these different groups like the Sauk Prairie group. I'm sorry if I'm not quite remembering, but I just saw something in town. We've got a group that is passionately looking into a problem where we've got this serious odor issue that's affecting quality of life, and we don't know how it might also be affecting health because of a large chicken farm. Of course, being right in the middle of the avian flu epidemic doesn't help us either, but I see there's a good chance of hope, and I think the more that we can all interact with these other groups that are doing all of these things that are bringing their passions up, the more we can maybe fight these trends that we're seeing in politics. So I just kind of want your opinion on that.
Yeah, I think it seems as though grassroots groups are popping up all over, and maybe there's a question of, you know, is there a limit to that, or could we just keep creating more and more groups, and is there maybe a challenge of coordinating them, and maybe you've seen this in not just in terms of lakes and rivers, but other resource areas too. Do you guys have any thoughts on small local groups and what they can and cannot accomplish?
I guess I think where the puck is going is to your lake, not to statewide policy stuff. One of the things that, looking back at history, that we did accomplish in the 80s and 90s and 2000 era is that the laws are now in pretty good shape to do effective lake management activities. You know, we have the laws that have to do with land trusts, laws that have to do with nonprofit organizations like lake associations. They're even eligible for state lake grants in some circumstances, and particularly the lake district law. There is a tremendous opportunity, whatever the role of the state government might be, for local people to organize and manage lakes. The institutional tools are better than they are almost anywhere in the country. And I think that's a very encouraging thing. As far as the looking forward, from my point of view, I think one thing that needs to happen is this. The Lakes Partnership has been a great success for 30-some years. And the relationships between the association, the university, and the Department of Natural Resources have grown, you know, tight, and they're effective. The downside in that is that this annual $200,000 grant to the Association of Lakes is used for things that are determined at that partnership level to be what we should be working on and talking about. And I think that that doesn't always translate into things that would be the priorities for advocacy by lakefront property owners. My sense is that in the near term, at least, the heart of advocacy for Wisconsin lakes has to be by doing a better job of bringing in and recruiting the very active participation of lakefront property owners who have, as Steve mentioned, the demographics of that group. They have a far greater than average capacity to support an advocacy organization and to influence the vote of members of the legislature.
And I don't know if this is maybe just to conclude, Eric, but Steve mentioned that I said during our conference call earlier in the week that we shouldn't be talking politics or too much politics. And there's a reason for that. It's because while Chapter 33 remains intact and the water resources account remains intact, that isn't guaranteed forever. And this organization needs to be very respectful of those who won elections in this state. It's said that elections matter, and they do. Statistically, probably 45% of the people in this room voted for Governor Walker and for the legislature we have right now, and they're in charge. And you don't think that, it pains me to say this too, but when I was in the Senate as recently as 2012, I mean, things have gotten very ugly. And so you don't think that there's not people in the Capitol who don't have the program for this Wisconsin Lakes Convention, and that they're not looking at the three, white male tree-hugging environmentalists up here who are presenting your keynote panel on a Friday morning? It's sad to say, but you bet they are. And they're saying, well, what the hell? What the hell's going on here? Where's our representatives up there giving our side of the story? Do we have to hear from these guys all the time? What's this organization all about? So you need to be aware politically. You need to be have your fingers on the pulse of what's going on in the Capitol, even though you may not get your sustenance from there in the near future or even long-term future. But you do need to be very respectful of who's in charge. You need to be aware of how favors are given and granted at the Capitol and just who gives them and grants them. And you can't be political as an organization. And these days, even having us on a panel is political, unfortunately. So as you go forward, that's my advice. Again, I told you earlier to ignore everything I said, so maybe you should, but I don't know. I think that's a good piece of advice.
I'd end with just, I have a sort of a personal mantra that I use for organizations and kind of for organizing life in general. I think it would apply to where you're at right now. One is to have a very realistic understanding of the environment, the landscape in which you're working. Two, to really know your friends and work to reward them, and to know who's unfriendly. If you don't have an honest appraisal of where the opposition is, you're not going to be able to find pressure points or opportunities to be respectful and supportive of people who align with your positions. So you have to know the environment you're in, you have to know the friends and enemies and so forth, but probably the most important thing is to really know yourself. It's that honest appraisal when you're, it's like when I'm shaving in the morning, I look in, I still see the same piercing blue eyes that were there 60 years ago. And I've been kidding myself that I'm still that same 20-year-old kid or whatever it happens to be. You can't have an illusion about what you are, what your capability is, some internal strategic planning that helps you suggest this is our base now, it's inadequate to do the following things we want to do, What do we have to modify? What do we have to change at the community level, at the Lake District level, at the triumvirate, the support group level, and at the individual level? What has to change to be able to accomplish the things you want to accomplish? And that kind of honest appraisal is sometimes a rough moment in one's life, but I think it's important going forward to wind up where you'd like the puck to be.
And with that, I'm going to close the panel and release these folks to take a seat out here and enjoy some of the coffee.